came from sometime behind something.
Well, RTÉ and TV it asked me to make a film, and they said, could you make a film about your philosophy of life? And I said, I don't have a philosophy of life. And if I had a philosophy of life, I would not put it in a film and make you watch it. So I said, well, okay, I try. Because I thought, they said that Mika is going to be like a, our series is like a personal essay series. So I thought, what is that? And then I thought, you know, maybe Chris Marker makes this kind of thing. So I love Chris Marker's films. So I thought, I'd try. So made a collection of stories. And in the end, it's my philosophy of life. You know, they tricked me into it. So in the end, it's what it was in the beginning.
It's something they know such personal about, you know, the people you love, about the Laurel, about everything, and at the same time, it's something that touches all of us, that makes us, you know, in a way, accept things maybe will be more difficult for us to accept. I think that's this, you know, how you see life and death, how you get there. And that's why I think it's such different film from everything that we see normally.
Of course, it's a film also about words and how we create the world through words, and so, and how what happens with stories, your own stories. This isn't really a movie about me and my dog. Not really. It looks a little bit like that, but of course, it's about what a story is. What happens when you repeat it too often? What happens when you forget it? What happens when somebody else tells your story and puts it on you? So that's the subplot of the surveillance culture. And of course it's also a film about up and freedom and fear as well. So it was quite strange to watch the film after Paris last night, and to see, to be reminded of fear and freedom. So those in the middle of the film is also something that Mingyur Rinpoche, who's my teacher, said, and I like it so much I put it in the middle. And he said, try to practice how to feel sad without being sad. I like this very, very much, because there's so many sad things in the world, so much sadness. And if you try to push it away, or if you try to pretend it's not there, it's gonna find you, it's gonna kind of eat you. So the idea is, you know, to acknowledge that, but do not, as he says, the most important thing, do not become sad. Because he's someone who said, we are here, the reason we're here, he says, is to have a very, 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 very good time. That's why we're here. So, I like this very much, because you have a choice of seeing things in a very pessimistic way or in an optimistic way. And who knows? There's no reason for either one. No reason to believe this or that. Not really. But you'll have more fun if you do this. So, the title of this film is Heart of a Dog, because it's about empathy. It's about trying to understand others, other beings, other dogs, other people.
I'd like to you share our conversation with us. It is if someone has to join us in asking one question or making a comment or anything.
Hi, good night. First of all, thank you for sharing this with us. I think it takes a lot of courage to open yourself like this to anyone, and you did it to the whole world, with the whole world. So thank you. I think it's really brave of you and really generous of you, so thank you for that. And I was wondering, when Art and TV proposed this to you or requested or spoke to you about making this film, how did you go about it? Did you start writing the script? Did you immediately think, I'll include that childhood memory and Lullabelle? And what was your first approach to, after the panic of how am I going to do this, how did you approach actually getting down to it? And also, this is a more personal question, did you get a new dog to help you cope with losing Lullabelle? Did you get a new dog?
Did I get a new dog?
Yeah.
Okay, in answering them in backwards order, I have a dog now, Little Will is his name, and he's in the film, he has a cameo role. He's the one wearing the little clogs in the rain. He does not play the piano. He doesn't paint. He's very good at eating. when I first started, I thought maybe I start with stories because the essay form is wonderful, but a little theoretical. So I like stories. So I started with dog stories, and then I built it with other things. So really, it started with the language. And then, of course, I like to make a lot of filters. So when I'm doing music, I make a lot of electronic filters. So visually, I did the same in the film. So doing these drawings, very crude animations. And then I thought I wanted to look like an old page ripped from a comic book. And so I put some of the old comic book filter on. And then, another filter that made it look like rough paper. So I wanted to make it very, very textual. So in the work that I usually do in live concerts, it's a combination of stories and music and imagery. So for me, it was a kind of a natural thing. However, what was different was how do you put an engine in this project, instead of like lots of, with a record you don't need a story. You can have 12 songs and they can be very different and they don't need to go somewhere. So I thought, how will I make a film that goes somewhere? And this is a problem that I've had before. And I had it once in a very misguided opera that I made once, based on Moby Dick. And this was my favorite book. If any of you are thinking of making an opera from your favorite book, don't do it. Because you've been so careful. And, you know, because if you love something so much, you're like, oh, so careful. And you have to be a little bit rough when you're making things. So I was also, I live in the same neighborhood that Herman Melville used to live in. So I thought, maybe he's going to come and find me and kill me. My book does not need to be a multimedia opera, thank you so much. It's a very good book as it is. But you know, one of the things that I learned in researching this opera was that at the beginning, the first draft of the book, there's no Captain Ahab. And I really like imagining Herman Melville sitting with his editor at the first meeting, and they're talking about the first draft, and the editor's going, Herman, it's a really, it's, It's a great book. It's very, very interesting. Lots of interesting details about ropes and sailing and waves. It's good. But you know, it really is basically guys go fishing. Where is this going? What are you doing here? So he said, how about, I don't know, it needs an engine. How about like a crazy captain? So if you read the book, you notice that the Captain Ahab doesn't appear for about a third of the book. Why? Because he wasn't written. And then suddenly, boom, he appears on the deck, and he's got an English accent, and he's like, avast! And he has this incredible rage. He's like an American King Lear. And he drives the ship, and it's a little bit stagey. It's a little bit, you know, overdone, let's say. But it does drive the ship towards a conclusion. It gives it some way to go. So that is how I made this film. It made so many questions. There are many, many questions. And I don't really like doing Q&As at the end of films because it's really, I don't have the answers to any of these questions. So that's for you to think about, you know, what's a story? How are these images working together? And so you're the better one to figure that out. So that's why it ends with a question as well. And it ends with that kind of Moby Dick question.
Well, I have also to thank you so, so very much for being who you are and for being so sensible to the world around you and to express it in the way you do. My question is from following your work as a following your work. And now, having the result of seeing this film, is more a question of how do you deal personally with being so much, as I think you are, exposed, open to all your senses, to the world around you, how to protect yourself, or on the other hand, how to allow it to go into you in such a deep way that it comes out in these works of so touching works of art. And the other question, it's always this play between reality and imagination in your storytelling. And I'm also wondering how you play with imagination in your daily life. Are you always this, if you have naturally this exercise of imagination so fertile in everyday life?
Well, in answer to the first part of your question, I think I try to remember to have curiosity. And just kind of think of like, how does that work? What is that? And this is, again, is why this film is about dogs, because they have, they study people. And they love people. They
chaos. And I think one of the big reasons that they love us is because we invented cars. You know, stick their head out the window. The other thing is, of course, we are their food supply. And if it was reversed and we're depending on them for food, we see what happens. Maybe it's not so going so well. So for me, I look to have this kind of inspired by this attitude of empathy and curiosity, you know, and being in the moment, not always thinking like, if only I could go back to this, or if only in the future sometime I could do this, I'd be happy. You know, I try to be in this time. I just show you an example of it. It's like this. We forget that we know everything. I mean, I'm very interested in going to Mars, of course. And, you know, I like tech stuff, I'm a geek. But I would also really love to use our power and research and curiosity, for example, to learn how to make music for animals that they would really understand. Imagine music for mosquitoes. They're like, just to have more contact with the creatures that are here, and also, of course, to understand each other. But I wanted to tell you a short story about a concert I got to do for dogs. And this was this happened when I was giving a speech for the Rhode Island School of Design and Art School. And I'm giving the commencement speech, and so I had a hat and a rose, and it was really hot, and it was really boring, and I'm feeling really guilty, because I have to say, you know, don't worry about your student loan. It would be no problem. Don't worry about getting a job in the art world. It will be so easy. So I'm thinking, oh, I'm such a fraud. And so Yo-Yo Ma is also there. He's also going to a little bit. So I'm talking to him and I'm saying, you know, I have this fantasy. Sometimes when I'm doing a concert, I look out and the whole audience is dogs. And he says, I have that fantasy too. I said, I'm kidding. And he said, yeah. So I said, okay, whoever gets to do that first invites the other. Okay. So then I was asked to do direct a big festival in Sydney, Australia. So I got to invite my favorite painters, my favorite writers, my favorite musicians, and dancers, so they all could come in. And then I also said to the producer, I want to do a concert for dogs. And he didn't say concert for dogs, no, he just wrote down concert for dogs. So we did this concert, and it was amazing. It was amazing because we thought maybe a few hundred dogs will come. Thousands of dogs. And it was on the, in the plaza, the Sydney Opera House, with the big sails and big stairs. And so they're filling the stairs, and they're filling all the little places we had. And all the veterinarians from Sydney are there with big park with their vans ready for any problems with the dogs. And so it was a short concert. And Elizabeth, who you saw in the film, the dog trainer, I said, well, I'm going to make some music for dogs where it's really quite high pitch, you know, where their hearing is excellent in the higher pitch. And she said, I don't think that's a good idea, because you don't know what's going to happen with a lot of dogs, too. So, we took it down a little bit. It began with an invocation for the whales, because the whales are right there in the harbor, right just a few feet away. And so you know, they're, we began with this music for them, because why do animals sing? You know, they do find each other, whales in the ocean, and dogs to establish their GPS pattern. You know, arf, I'm over here, arf, I'm 2 miles here. Do they make a map of their world so they know where everyone is? They're pack animals. So anyway, the thing about so the concert began, and I just noticed there were a lot of Australian dogs who just want to rock. They're ready, so they were like, nah. And my favorites were the droolers, and the droolers were like, in the front row, and they're just like, so sweet. Because they didn't know why they were there. Because it's not it's a normal situation. It's not a dog run, it's not a park. It's, what are they doing there? And so they were quite polite. There was no, you know, nothing, no fights, nothing. So at the end, I said, you know, it's been so quiet. Let's do some barking. So let's start with the small ones. Like, add the mediums, okay, the big ones, and for 5 minutes, thousands of dogs are just barking really loudly, just because they could, and just for the fun of it. So it was probably the most beautiful 5 minutes of sound I've ever heard, because it was just pure joy. That's all, it was just only for that. So that was, in answer to your question, I think that I go for pure joy. I try to find something that I will feel that feeling. That's what I go for.
Yeah.
Wow, thank you very much for that. Oh, yeah. I thought that was especially interesting from the point of view of telling a story. Thank you for telling us your story, for the images you presented. I think from an ethnographic point of view, you've really done something impressive there. But I would like to know to what degree you feel that you've now given your story away. Do you feel you still have ownership over that story? Do you feel satisfied by the presentation of your story, or do you feel that you had to give some things up for the purpose of film? I'd like to know how you now feel about your story after that film.
Well, I don't feel so much like ownership of this thing, and also I have a lot of stories I didn't tell. And lots of things that only I think are funny, and nobody else thinks it's funny. So, it's called, you know, your private life. So, I have that. But anytime I so-called finish something, I'm never really like happy sitting back and like, oh yes, that's great. I see only the problems. Because I'm an artist, I'm making things, and so I'm trying to fix them all the time. So, I see some of the things I could have made a little bit better, but I also learned a lot about my own stories from working on this, because I didn't have an end to this film. And so one of my brothers said, I know you're working on a film, and I have all these boxes of films from our childhood, and could you transfer them since you're making a film? And I was like, kind of busy. I did the transfer some of the films, and in the films were my mother pushing the stroller of my little brothers, and me ice skating at the lake, the island, this whole frozen winter world of lost world. And so I called my brothers and I said, guys, do you remember the day I almost drowned you? And they said, yes, we do. They're identical twins, and so they have like an outward brain. You know, they have another person. excellent memories. And so I said, because I found this film of you and when you were little in the strollers, and you know, remember when I, you know, when I sang, and they said, you're not going to put that in a movie, are you? And I said, I don't know, would you mind? Because, you know, and they're very, very, they're cool. So they said, yeah, okay, it's okay with us. So it was, I don't think that was, you know how everyone has their childhood stories. You say, what kind of kid were you? And you have the story you typically pull out. I was a shy kid, or I was a punk, or I was a good student, or whatever. And it's a very short story. Because nobody, when they say, what kind of child were you? They don't really want to know. In the way that a psychiatrist might want to say, what kind of childhood did you have? And then it's a 20-year answer. You know, it's the same like, how are you today? People do not want to really know how you feel that day at all. Of course not. It's social clue. It's just what we do and we say things like this. It's not, it's nothing. But so I learned about that particular story was not one of my typical stories of my childhood, so it felt quite strange to use it, but I learned about it just by chance, by just pulling these old films out. And it of course fits in with the thing I was trying to build about forgetting and remembering, and kind of thing that does with words. Is there another last question?
Is this film about the loss of empathy? Is this film about the loss of empathy between the human beings, and you found in the heart of the dog the empathy that you would like to find in this process of liberation?
Say that one a different way. I didn't get the question.
Do you think that humanity has lost its empathy?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I didn't mean to say that we've lost empathy. It's always saying, I would never try to say something like that. I mean, I don't know, first of all. And that's why it's a film made of questions, you know, I don't know. And just, of course, making a film is an act of empathy with others that I think that you will, that I think I'm a normal enough person, average enough person to think that this is funny or interesting, and that you might as well. So it's not, that's an act of empathy, that you would enter into that these stories and empathetically think, oh, what do I think? So it's a very challenging thing because it asks you to do so many things. You have to look through the eyes of a point of view of a dog, then suddenly looking through the point of down the lens of a surveillance camera, and then suddenly you're floating in the bardo, you know, so you're bodiless in this, you know. It's not like you're identifying with the hero. It's a work of stories and of course Wittgenstein is involved in there because he says, you know, the world is made of words, and so how do you shape it? And how, this is also the fallibility of words, and this is why I used my mother's deathbed speech as the second story. She was a very, very formal woman. And so when she died, she waited for her 8 children to come. It was almost like she steps up to a microphone and says, thank you so much for coming. And we're like, whoa. And then she gets distracted because everything's shutting down. She's a wonderful horsewoman and dog lover. So she sees all these dogs and the animals on the ceiling. She starts talking to them. Then she's back to talking to you, to history, saying goodbye. Very formal way, but the language is breaking apart, it's shredding, it's going, I was like, so I thought this is such an amazing image of trying to to grab the world, to try to show it through language, and how that often doesn't work. So in a film, of course, when a story breaks down, you have images, you have music, so you use a lot of those different elements in telling the story. It's also why I use these fast words. And for you, this was making me crazy, seeing the fast words in two languages. I was getting a migraine. Sorry about that. Because it was quite chaotic. It's meant to be chaotic. It's meant to talk to directly to the person in you that never speaks. The one who's like a kind of the silent, like witness. And also, one who's like a little bit critical of, you know, like listening to, for example, it's listening to me right now, going on and about talking, and you know, sometimes when you're talking, you think, this sounds ridiculous, and you realize, it's me talking, you know, it's me sounding ridiculous, but you can't stop it, you know, so it's that silent person who recognizes that kind of thing, I'm trying to talk to sometimes, so when you see words with your eyes, they come into your mind in a different way than if you hear them. So I'm just trying to play with how stories get told, and you know. And again, the subplot of the surveillance culture is about what happens when somebody else tells your story and puts it on you and just goes. Ch-ch-ch-ch. For example, like let's say you're on Amazon buying a book, and you buy a book, and then 2 seconds later, bing. Tim, you love that book. You're going to love this book. No, the book I just bought, that was a gift. Don't think you know me or what I just bought. I didn't buy it for myself. how our culture, you know, always is trying to make you into a certain, put you into a certain frame. And it's, of course, it's a corporate thing. It's about same thing Facebook is. It's about, you know, branding yourself. It's putting, it's a kind of marketing technique. So the stories, of course, get shorter and shorter and shorter. And I like stories to get longer and longer and longer. So that's why this film is so full of words. I'm out of words. I don't know about you, but. Thank you.